back to TalkNorth.com. Thank you for listening. If you can, please download before you listen. It helps our business. I'd also like to thank our producer, Brandon Morton, and let you know if you'd like to sponsor this program or any of the programs on the network, you can reach me at jsouhan47@gmail.com. I never need to see Rob Gronkowski on TV ever again. You know, I always look forward to those rare Sundays during the NFL season when I can actually just sit back and watch TV. And then there's Rob Gronkowski, kind of an advertisement for why steroids are really bad for your brain, on TV, just wild-eyed.
In a turtleneck, no less.
In a turtleneck, struggling to get through sentences. It was just a little more than I needed. You know, that's the funny thing about the NFL, John, is – boy, when you have a team you care about, it can be the most fascinating, dramatic sport there is. But if you ever just sit around on a day when the team you care most about or follow isn't playing, boy, there's a lot of bad football. A
lot of bad football, absolutely.
And a lot of bad announcing of the bad football, and
bad
a lot
analysis,
of cliches,
yes.
Bad analysis. Though the word football used as a noun, adjective, adverb, verb, gerund, it can wear you out a little bit.
It can do that. Here's the one thing that I will give the NFL that's interesting is there's a lot of talk in the NBA right now about ratings declining. I think a lot of that is circumstantial given that, you know, the Warriors, all their injuries, Zion is out, those kinds of things. But one of the talking points that comes up when you're saying why is this not resonating? Is that the analysis of NBA games comes from the Barclays and, you know, the former players. And it seems like those players analyze the game in a much harsher tone.
It's true. Yeah, and that's one of the things I love about them. Yeah. But you're right. Maybe that's not good for the
Troy
brand.
Aikmans, the Gronkowskis, whatever. Like, every Sunday is a celebration of this mediocre product and how great it is. And nobody talks about the 49ers in the 80s and, you know, how it was better when it was Montana to Rice. They just don't do that. And I wonder if that does affect sort of the perception of the games a little bit. Obviously, the NFL has so many built-in advantages, 16 games. You know, the regular season really means something, all of these other things. But there is that little element that, as kind of mindless and dumb as a lot of the pre-games and the in-game analysis is, almost all of it boils down to, man, this is great. And boy, you guys, you're doing the right thing by devoting 4 hours a day to this. It just, you know, maybe it's genius and maybe we're the ones that are out on the other side of it.
Well, it's something we've discovered in our society too. Here's the deal. Propaganda works.
Yeah.
Propaganda, that's why it's like, you know, I used to have these conversations with baseball officials and we talk about steroids, and every once in a while somebody would slip and say, God, why do these players have to take steroids? And of course the answer was always because they work.
Yeah.
Propaganda works.
No
Tell
doubt.
People that the product is great, even when the product obviously always isn't. It actually works on people, and they do. They sell it. They protect the shield. They celebrate the game. And again, if the local team is good, then all that propaganda works because it ties into this, you know, into the dramatic feel of being an NFL fan where, oh my God, got to beat this team. Oh my God, every team, every week is different. Every game's a challenge. I mean, it all ends up sounding logical if your local team's good.
Yeah. And I do think that, you know, the fan bases in Jacksonville and in, you know, Miami right now and a few other places are tuning out for sure. But yeah, it's, you made the good point though about, I kind of was flipping back and forth through some games on Sunday, and, you know, the Vikings were not playing, and it's just like, what am I doing?
I know.
Why am I doing this? I don't know.
If I didn't have dogs, I don't think I would have watched the games, but it's such an easy thing to have on while you're rolling around the ground wrestling with your dogs, you know?
Yep, absolutely.
So he's John Krasinski from The Athletic. I'm Jim Suhan from The Star Tribune. This is our Viking Update show. We all have two Viking shows on TalkNorth.com. One is this one. One is Jeff Diamond's Vikings and NFL Insider. Jeff offers kind of the executive view of the NFL and the Vikings. John and I look at it more from a writer and fan perspective. We will also talk a little Gopher football in this episode because I was at Northwestern on Saturday, and the two football teams combined are really putting on a show this year. It has been fun in that regard. I want to start here. Vikings' next game is at Seattle on a Monday night. And I have to admit, you know, I don't think like a fan, but there's always that little part of you that is still the 14-year-old who fell in love with sports. I got to tell you, Russell Wilson is probably my favorite quarterback, might be my favorite athlete to watch. The fact that he was, you know, not even a highly prized quarterback prospect, and he just does nothing but win and produce incredible historical statistics, incredible passing and running statistics. His team always wins, even after we've seen there's no more Legion of Boom. He's changed out receivers. He's changed out running backs. He is the constant. He keeps on winning. So to me, to get to go to Seattle and watch Russell Wilson against the Vikings defense is going to be fascinating.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think he and Lamar Jackson are the favorites for MVP. Lamar's probably a little bit ahead of him right now, but I mean, you watch the guy play and it's magic, like every time that he hits the field. Some of the throws that he makes are out of this world. And you know, that I almost think that his arm talent is kind of underrated when people look at his game. I mean, they see a guy who's a little bit undersized. He's obviously got, he's an outspoken leader, kind of that kind of guy. He can move around in the pocket for sure. But really, when you get down to the nitty gritty of it, the guy can just sling it from all different angles into the tightest of windows. I mean, he is remarkable the way that he can do it. And he's so inventive with the way that he plays the game. And he can ad lib at a, you know, at the drop of a hat. He's phenomenal. And I think it's going to be an incredible, incredible challenge for the Vikings secondary that has not played very well of late to corral this guy. And I have to imagine that Zim went to his ranch in Kentucky and just spent 5 days absolutely poring over every little possible thing he can do to A, get his cornerbacks playing better, but B, prepare for, you know, the just this riverboat gambler magician guy that gets out there and does things that no one is ready to see.
I have another point to make on that topic. We do want to thank our sponsors, Twill in the Edina Galleria, Scott Dayton's shop, a great place to shop. Tony Hoaglund, Hoaglund, your State Farm agent who works out of Champlin, Minnesota, and BiteSquad.com, promo code TALKNORTH. Use TALKNORTH for your first delivery fee waived. And also, please follow us on Twitter at TALKNORTHPOD. We're going to have some interesting developments with the network in the next couple of months. We'd like to keep you up to date with all that, and we'll have some new shows for you to enjoy. And also thank you to our longtime producer, Brandon Morton. The amazing thing, too, is that, you know, it wasn't that long ago when there were actually NFL executives and NFL analysts saying, Lamar Jackson, maybe you play him a slot receiver, maybe he's a safety, something like this. And ESPN's QBR, which tries to take quarterback play and incorporate situational play and running and kind of give you a total picture of a quarterback's effectiveness. I don't know if it's a perfect stat, but it's probably the most fair stat because it tries to factor in everything. Right now, among quarterbacks who are starters, the top five in QBR are Lamar Jackson, Patrick Mahomes, Dak Prescott, Russell Wilson, and Deshaun Watson. Five black quarterbacks are in the top five, and I think Kyler Murray is like number nine, and then the number one free agent in this next offseason is probably going to be Teddy Bridgewater. It is amazing that it wasn't that long ago that someone was actually saying, take this great college quarterback, make him a wide receiver, and whether that's blatant racism or just not being able to see past your own flawed thinking, it's ridiculous.
It is ridiculous, but I do think, like, when you look at the NFL as a whole, one of its major problems is, and it's not, I don't even know, I don't, I'm sure race probably plays a factor in it, but I think it's more of just being slow to adapt, slow to adopt new thinking and sort of quote unquote go out on a limb. The Ravens went out on a limb with Lamar Jackson and you look what, you know, it's doing for them. I mean, look at the Bears took frickin' Mitch Trubisky over Watson and Mahomes. Why did they do that? He's this big white prototypical quarterback that
hadn't played much college football.
Right.
He played one season.
But he kind of looked like the quarterbacks who were successful in this league decades ago. You have to be able to adapt and advance in if you're going to stay relevant. And that fortunately is starting to happen now. Whether it was the advent of the spread systems in college that kind of maximized sort of the need for athleticism, or I don't know what it is, but these guys are getting the chances that they deserve, and they are absolute stars at the position. And so I do think that now, because you're seeing more and more of this, of success in this type of system with this type of quarterback, other teams will try to copy it again, and they'll go looking for the next Lamar Jackson. And instead of saying, no, he should be a receiver, boy, I don't know where he fits. This guy is such an incredible player. Let's figure out a system that can cater to those talents and not try and put him into the same system that Peyton Manning would run, or that, you know, another slower footed player would run. They're going to embrace what these guys can do. And, you know, you look at sort of those five players that you mentioned, and they're all different in some ways. I mean, Lamar is a runner and dynamic that way. Russell Wilson can move around, but I think Watson and Prescott are both more classic pocket passers. Mahomes is, you know, out of this world with just, but he's definitely more, I'll stay in the pocket and I'll make something happen with my arm. So you can do it all sorts of different ways. But the problem was, is that for a long time, everyone looked at black quarterback, he must just be able to run. That's all we can do with him.
Yeah, it used to crack me up when people would talk about Teddy Bridgewater being like a running quarterback. No, he was a pocket passer.
Absolutely.
Who ran when he had to.
Yeah.
And just because he ran effectively occasionally didn't mean he was a running quarterback. One other point I want to make on this. I do want to thank Twill and the Edina Galleria. Twill Edina on Instagram. I could tell you, I could describe their clothes, but just go to twillmn.com, which is their website, or Twill Edina on Instagram, and you'll see their clothes. They're just beautiful and comfortable and relaxing. I know I have a few more purchases I'm going to make here in the next month.
I'm here with my wife, Stacy. We went to Twill in the Edina Galleria the other day. We saw Scott Dayton, and I bought the nicest sport jacket I've ever owned, the most comfortable pants I've ever owned. They're Bracks, a nice pair of loafers that I can wear to the ballpark. I think they're called Tracks. And I bought a bunch of Stenstrom short sleeve shirts to go with my Stenstrom nice dress shirts. And, you know, I used to wear just disposable clothes. Now when I buy something, I buy it at Twill. I know it's going to last me the rest of my life, and it's going to be comfortable.
And on top of that, it's not just the best stuff you've ever had, but it's really everyday things that you can wear and that will fit all occasions.
Twill in the Edina Galleria, twillmn.com, Twill on Instagram.
You know, when Tony Dungy was the defensive coordinator here, I talked to him constantly. And one of the things he said that really stuck with me is he said, you know, and that was during a time when there weren't many black head coaches. He was trying to become a head coach. He wasn't having any luck. He was always in the interviews. He wasn't getting hired. And what he told me was, I don't think it's blatant racism. I just think owners want to hire somebody who looks like Don Shula, or who looks like Chuck Knoll. And I think that is, and so that mean, so that was my favorite old quote, kind of explaining that mentality. My favorite quote from this season is Jim Harbaugh saying, you know, I'm lucky. I don't have an offensive philosophy.
John Harbaugh. Yeah.
Jim Harbaugh doesn't have an offensive philosophy either, right. But this is different. John Harbaugh said, I'm lucky. I don't have an offensive philosophy. So I didn't have to like fit him into my system. I just said, hey, this guy's a really good player. Let's just do what he does well. And they might be the best team in football with him doing it.
Yeah, and you know, I think that is one of the things. What do we see from coaching hires more often than not? the genius coordinator, whether it's offensive or defensive. They have the system that is going to solve all of the problems. And Sean McVay, you know, whoever it is, bring him in. Mike Zimmer with his defense, you know, you bring it in, and it's the coach is the star. And they are like the mad scientists or the puppet masters that are pulling all of the strings. And these players are just plugged in.